Good morning, everybody. I don't think we all had our coffee. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Oh, there we go. So good to see all of you this morning. You know, it really is a wonderful time when we come into the God's sanctuary. We see you talking and smiling amongst yourselves. It's wonderful to be a family in Christ. Amen? Amen. As we start this morning, we want to read from Psalm 28, verses 6 through 9. Blessed be the Lord, for he has heard the voice of my pleas for mercy. The Lord is my strength and my shield. In him my heart trusts. I am helped. My heart exults. And with my song I give thanks to him. The Lord is the strength of his people. He is the saving refuge of his anointed. Oh, save your people and bless your heritage. Be their shepherd and carry them forever. Amen.
Amen. It says in Ephesians 6, verse 13, put on the full armor of God that you may be able to stand your ground. Let's stand and sing, Soldiers of Christ Arise, number 723. Panoply of God. That means anything proceeding completely or forming a magnificent covering, a full suit of armor. That's what panoply is. Now let's turn over to number 734. It does say in Ephesians 6, that same chapter, verse 10, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Let's sing together, be strong in the Lord.
Be strong, be strong, be strong.
Say, the victory is yours, and greet them.
And a hush falls over the crowd. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to TFB. How are you all doing? Good, good, good. Good-looking group. Okay, first of all, our connection card. We know we hear this every week, but sometimes there's things going on, and if there's something you need us to know about, or if you're new here and you want to find out some information about our church and what we're all about, please fill out one of those cards and put it in the box in the back there. Thanksgiving potluck tonight. Woo! Woo-hoo! All right, so and there's the way the food thing works. If your last name begins from A through L, bring a main dish. M through S, a salad, and T through Z, a side dish. That's it? Any questions? Okay. All right. For fellowship, we're looking for volunteers to provide goodies for the patio time. So those goodies out there, it'd be great if you maybe brought some of your own for us. We might like your goodies better than some of the other ones. I don't know. But if you'd like to do that, please sign up. It'd be great just to have a variety of things to choose from. So we would love to have that. Then a congregational meeting in 2 weeks, December 3rd. We're going to be discussing the budget and the deacon board officers. So, 2 weeks from now, there's a budget statement. So please pick one of those up so you can be ready with your questions or your comments or whatever you got. Okay, so actually I was just loving the two hymns. Is Put in the Armor of God and Be Strong in the Lord. I'm gonna give a plug for our small groups. And one small group in particular. But we were talking just this morning, in my Sunday school class, going through this book here. I'm sure you can see it very easily from where you are. You can see that it's black and white. That's probably about all you can see. But it says, Be Like Christ. That's the name of the book that we're going through. And it's written by somebody I know very well, or at least pretty well. That would be me. But we were talking this morning just about how important our relationship with the Lord is and that he gives us the power and the strength to do the things that we need to do. It's not on our own. It's because of his Holy Spirit that he gives us. And the reason I'm saying, first of all, we just started doing the book here last week or so. So if you're interested in being part of a small group, we have the Sunday school class, which meets from 9 to 10 on Sunday mornings. And Wednesday afternoon, we have a men's study that goes from 11 till 12 on Wednesday mornings. So if you're looking for a small group to be part of, that would be a couple options. And we're spending the next maybe 6 or so weeks going through this. In the book, just real quickly, called Be Like Christ. So even though you shouldn't judge a book by its cover, maybe you can judge it by its title. I don't know. That's up to you. What's that?
Judge it by its smell.
It smells like paper. And in the book, I do talk about things like what does it mean to be like Christ, biblical support for and against, understanding things like the sin, flesh, our sinful nature, just looking at different things that affect our discipleship. And that's one of the beauties of being part of a small group. Is coming here on Sunday mornings is great, and it's what we should do. But we also need, throughout the rest of our week, to feed on some spiritual food, that we can get together with other believers, that we can, be part of that, and we can grow in our strength and love of the Lord, and learn to put on His armor, put on the full armor of God, not put on your own armor, put on the full armor of God, be strong in the Lord. Those are the things we need to do. And then, like in 1 John 2:6, it says, if you say you abide in Him, we ought to walk in the same manner as He walks. So we should be learning to walk like Jesus. So anyway, if you're interested in being part of a small group and find out what those are, we can give you the information on what's available in terms of throughout the week and what they're studying and those kind of things. So that's it. Thank you very much. And Ben, take it away.
All right. Thank you, Tom. Yeah, exciting. And so we're going to pick up from where we left off last week with I Speak Jesus. So let's go ahead and do that. Stand, if you can, and we'll praise the Lord together.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
And I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety, to every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy.
Jesus for my family. I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for me. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. I'm calling on the God of Mary, whose favor rests upon the lowly. I know with you things are possible. I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy courageous. I may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God,
children, then you hear your children now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. are providing now. You are the same God. You are the same God.
You moved in power then. God, move in power now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were a healer then. You are a healer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were a savior then. You are a savior now. You are the same God. You are the same God.
God, thank you that you're the same yesterday, today, forever. And you're there with the power to help us to serve you the way we ought to. Thank you, and open our ears to be able to hear your word today. For Jesus' sake, amen.
Amen. Oh, anybody else feel like I do today? Anybody else back hurts? Anybody else got like teary eyes? Not because of the music or anything like that. Anybody else a little under the weather? Anybody else feeling maybe a little defeated, perhaps? Maybe a little sore, a little tired? Yeah, today is for you then. If you're not feeling any of those, get out of here. No, I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. I want to report on a couple of things from yesterday. We had an amazing opportunity yesterday morning to get out in our community. We went to Torrance High School, which is our neighbor right over that way. Those that were able to come out on that morning, we filled 87 bags. Which is why I'm tired and sore. Of pine needles, leaves, trash. You name it, 87. Anyways, it was a great morning. Pay attention for things like that in the future because we want to make sure everyone has the opportunity to get out in our community and to serve, okay? Because we want to be known as a church that doesn't just sit here, right? But we get out, we move out. We were able to this week also send out how many boxes? 170 boxes for Operation Christmas Child, of which our children and the ladies, when they gathered together, made up about half of those, more than half of those. So praise God for our ministry-minded folks in this church. Also, last night, we had a chance to gather together with our youth for our Friendsgiving. Something like 30 of us got together and had some amazing food, and I'm still feeling that today, too. Played some games, just had a great time together. Continue to pray for our youth ministry as we're looking still for a youth pastor. God is good. We're going to trust in him in this process. Thank you. I know you've been praying for me. I appreciate that. Keep praying for me and keep praying for our youth staff, but they're doing a great job, you guys. Just loving Jesus and loving on our students. Nadine with our kids as well. So praise God for the ministry that goes on here at TFB. Spiritual warfare is what we're talking about today. Spiritual warfare. All right. Is it real? Is it not real? Is it overblown? Is it understated? Is it simple? Maybe it's a little bit confusing. C.S. Lewis said in his introduction to the Screwtape Letters, which, by the way, if you haven't read, you should read that. It's a book that actually gets into possibly the mind of the enemy and how he wants to trick humankind and things like that. And he said in his introduction, he said, the general public prefers to either ignore the forces of evil altogether, to pretend they don't exist, and to use cartoon images of a devil with horns and hooves as an argument to that effect. Because you can't believe in that nonsense, so you can't believe it in a devil at all, can you? Or it tends to take an unhealthy interest in everything demonic. The devil made me do it, right? That's an excuse we hear often, which can be just as bad in the long run. Perhaps you find yourself this morning at one of those extremes where everything is demonic. The spiritual battle is all there is, and there's nothing else outside that. Or, that's just a bunch of fables and fairy tales, and that's not real, and all that kind of jazz. Or maybe you're somewhere in the middle. Wherever you find yourself, and before we say anything else, I do want to point out the fact that the battle is real. It is a real battle. We have a real enemy. He's not a figment of someone's imagination. He is not a fairy tale. He is real. And so we have to be ready for the battle. There is a reality of a battle that is going on all around us. But I do want to say that it is a battle with an outcome that is assured, because we are on the winning team. And if I get weepy today, it's because I'm just tired. But God is good. God is good. And his word is real and true and living and active. And God is good. And he wins. We are on the winning side because we are on the side of Christ. We are on the side of Christ. Last week, we took a break from our study of Ephesians to receive an impassioned message from Bobby Gupta. Who wasn't inspired last week? Who wasn't inspired last week by that? Right? On what it means to be ambassadors for Christ in an uncertain world. 2 weeks ago, we finished looking at the concept of submission within the family between parents and children. We learned that children are called to obey and parents are called to lead. We looked at submission in the marketplace, where we learned that masters or employers are called to be fair and bondservants or employees are called to do their job. And this week we move on from Paul's thoughts on submission, really his thoughts on walking in a manner worthy, to the final section. If you remember, Watchman Nee saw three sections in Ephesians, and he called them sit, walk, and who knows the third? Stand. Sit, walk, and stand. So we move on from the walking aspect to now we're ready to stand. So today we're looking at what it means to stand firm, dressed for spiritual battle. And because it is a battle, we need to pray. So please join me in prayer. Father, thank you for your goodness to us, your faithfulness to us. We can call upon the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and the God of David and the God of Mary, the God of Moses. We can call upon this God because he is the same God yesterday and today and forever. And the battles that you were fighting and winning back then are the same battles that you are fighting and winning now. You were a healer then. You are a healer now. You were a savior then. You are a savior now. You moved in power then. God, move in power now. Move in power. May we understand this important passage, what it means to be dressed for battle. Take our stand against the enemy. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So please turn to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. We're going to read verse 10 through 20 today. Before we read, I do want to mention something that Clint Arnold, professor and chairman of the New Testament Department at Biola, who's a resident expert on Ephesians, but also on the power circles and influence in the church at Ephesus and also today in the world. He said this. He said, the call to acquire divine strengthening for the purpose of engaging the spirit forces of evil is not an irrelevant appendix to the epistle. So we don't just get to chapter 6 and say, oh, this is kind of like, I don't know, Paul's being weird or something like that. No, this really is the climax, the conclusion of this book of Ephesians. It is a crucial part, he says, to which the rest of the epistle has been pointing to. And so I want to say we need to listen up today, friends. We need to listen up. Now, if you saw the outline at all, you will see a classic Baptist three-point sermon is awaiting us this morning. Stand strong, stand firm, and stand constant in prayer. So we're going to start with standing strong. So open up to Ephesians chapter 6. We're going to begin with verse 10. If you open up with me there. Look at verse 10 through 13. It says this, finally, be strong in the Lord. And in the strength of his might, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. And so the call is quite clear, is it not? We are called to stand strong in the Lord. That's the command there, to be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Commentator Merkel said, amid intense spiritual warfare, the power to fight and stand firm comes through a genuine relationship with the resurrected and ascended Christ. That is where it starts, friends. If we want to have any success in this life, to live victoriously in this life, we have to be rooted and grounded in Jesus Christ. I shouldn't even have to say that, right? That's why we're here. But I do have to remind us of that. Paul has to remind the church of that many, many times. Lest we think that we can fight this battle on our own, Paul is quick to remind us that we cannot. In fact, for my grammar nerds out there, this is in the passive voice, which means be strengthened or be made strong. And according to Potsia, the present passive verb literally means be made strong in the Lord continually. So it's not something that I can do. No matter how much I pump iron, no matter how many bags of trash I lift. No, that's a whole other subject. Just kidding. But it's about God working in me. And it's about me availing myself to him and allowing him to strengthen me, right? And so we are being made strong in the Lord continually. And so Paul introduces then the concept of the armor of God. He tells the church to put on the full armor of God. In a minute, we're going to look at the different pieces of that armor. But for now, notice, we are called to put on the full armor of God. As Wiersbe said, we dare not omit any part of it. Why? Because the enemy is way too crafty for us. And if we forget to put on any piece, he's going to find that chink in that armor, right? He's going to find that weak spot, and he's going to shoot that arrow straight through. Okay, so we have to put on the full armor of God to be fully protected against his schemes. Peter understands this. 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. Okay, that's the enemy that we have. Now, that is the only way that we will stand against him. Watchman Nee said, the Greek verb stand with its following preposition against in verse 11, really means hold your ground. Hold your ground. Basically, the Lord has already won the fight. He has already defeated the enemy. He has already made inroads into enemy territory. And so our job now is to hold the ground that he has reclaimed. It's to hold that ground, to take our stand against the enemy. Paul then reminds the church that the battle is not against flesh or blood. It's against the rulers, authorities, powers, spiritual forces. Notice that little word, against. Against. It's repeated each time. Now, that's not really necessary, is it? Against the powers, against the rulers, against the authorities, against the spiritual forces, because we have little things called commas, so you don't need to say against every time. So do you think he has a purpose behind that? Yeah, there's a definite purpose behind that. It's very intentional. James Boyce said, it's not just a string of things that we should be concerned about. There are enemies, and we fight against them. It's a way of saying with emphasis that in the warfare in the Christian life, Christians are really up against it. Okay? Now, it, of course, doesn't come at us all in the same way, right? And we already know that we tend to, you know, glorify certain images and things like that. Anybody ever seen the devil with the horns and the little tail and the pitchfork and all that stuff? Now, that's not what he looks like, because that image is actually quite silly, is it not? Our enemy is not silly, friends. Our enemy is real. And in fact, it says that he disguises himself as an angel of light. So an angel of light, roaring lion, the adversary, the deceiver, you name it, he's there. Satan, the devil, Lucifer, whatever. Right? So our enemy is real. So we need to know that, and we are up against it. Now, some of us may be wondering what the difference is between those four different groups of bad guys, rulers, authorities, powers, spiritual forces, etc. Let me share with you what Merkel said regarding these again. It says, these four designations are sometimes viewed as four distinct rankings of evil spirits that together constitute all the demonic forces. Such a view, however, is difficult to maintain, since the relationship between these powers and the devil is never delineated or described. In addition, Paul uses several different combinations of terms in such lists like these. Because we're not given any more information, any attempt to catalog or classify evil spirits is just pure speculation. Okay? So we can be more sure of this, that these powers are personal, demonic beings, and not merely impersonal social forces or structures of thought. You see, the social forces and the structures of thought are what we call the world. The world is against us. That's the system. But the enemy is different. The enemy is personal. Now, is Satan everywhere all at the same time? No. He is limited. He is not omnipresent. But he's got a lot of servants on his team. And while he cannot possess you and I, if we are true believers in Christ, he can indeed oppress us. And fight against us. As Hughes said, in fact, the word wrestle, as it says there, indicates a hand-to-hand, mano-a-mano battle, right? So this is not something that's impersonal, okay? And as Hughes said, the evil described here is not the trivialized, pallid Satan of folklore commanding a gang of spirits that look like winged possums. Now, all those little suckers are quite terrifying. Are they not, Miss Emily? Yes, they are. Possums are ugly. We've got, like, quite a few hanging on our walls outside of the parsonage over there. But anyways, they're ugly, but silly, right? Because if we're really afraid of possums, I don't know. Hopefully that scratches the itch there, that we don't need to, like, define what each of these things mean. Although I do want to ask this question. Has anyone read the Frank Peretti book, This Present Darkness, before? Like, a few of you have, okay? Not all of you. I think I might have been actually a bit too young to read that book when I read it. I think I was, like, in junior high or something. And so I don't remember much of it, other than to say I was quite concerned, and it, in fact, even infiltrated my dreams. Ready for this? I had this recurring dream that I was being chased by a demon or by demons. And I was holding a little candle while these demons were chasing after me, trying to blow out my candle. Okay, maybe it wasn't the pretty book at all. Maybe it was just the song, "This Little Light of Mine Won't Let Satan It Out." Ready? "I'm gonna let it shine." Okay, right? In all seriousness, though, 1 John 5:19 says this: "We know that we are from God, and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one." And let me say that again. We are from God, but the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. And this is John writing to the church. That's crazy. The whole world lies in his power, and we cannot deny that. Martin Luther, in one of his famous hymns, said, "For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate, on earth is not his equal." And therefore, as Clint Arnold said, because of the ominously threatening nature of the enemy, the readers need the power of God in order to stand. See, Paul wants his readers to know that their chances of success are more than possible. They are more than possible. They are probable. Victory will be a reality if they depend upon the divine power within them. You see, you and I have been given the Holy Spirit of God that acts as a seal of our salvation. And it's not a spirit of fear and timidity, right? No, it's a spirit of power. Power. In fact, he told his disciples as they met in that upper room, as they waited for his direction in life, he says, "You will receive power when my Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." Not you might be. Not you should be even. You will be. You will be. So the good news is, though the enemy and his forces may be daunting, if we couldn't stand against them, Paul wouldn't have used the word able. It's a small little word, but it packs a punch. We have the ability with Christ to stand against them. Paul tells the church in Colossians 2:15 that he disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. And again, we can stand strong in the Lord knowing that he is the victor, and through him, we are the champions, my friend. The rest of the verse from that hymn by Martin Luther says this: "The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him." All we need to do, as Paul says and repeats again, is to take up that full armor of God to withstand in the evil day and to stand firm. Is that enough stands for y'all there? I think so. And just in case it wasn't, he says it one more time in verse 14, which we're turning to right now. Look at me, please. Look with me, please. Not at me. Verse 14 through 17. So, thanks. 14 through 17 says this: "Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God." And we're going to go ahead and stop right there. In his description of the armor, Paul draws on the imagery of Isaiah. In Isaiah 59:17, Isaiah depicts the Lord as a divine warrior who is clothed with armor as he prepares for battle to defend and to vindicate his people. 59:17 of Isaiah says, "He put on righteousness as a breastplate and helmet of salvation on his head. He put on garments of vengeance for clothing, and he wrapped himself in zeal as a cloak." You see, the armor is effective against the enemy because it is not our armor, it is the armor of God. It is the armor of God. Paul picks up that imagery from Isaiah. Note that most of these are actually defensive in nature. We would say there's only one offensive weapon in this arsenal, the sword being that offensive weapon. But we are to stand with the belt of truth. Now, what does a belt do? Make sure your pants don't fall on the ground, right? Or in those days, it made sure your robe was nicely cinched around you, because who, when you're going to battle, wants a robe that's flapping around in the wind, right? Nobody wants that. It's to hold your things together. I was coaching volleyball, and this game on Friday night got so intense, and I was like straining at it, that my belt buckle actually broke. And then my belt fell off. Now, praise God, the pants weren't that loose, so they didn't fall off, praise the Lord, but it was just really weird. And but anyway, but the belt's important, right? It holds everything together. And our spiritual belt is what? Truth. The thing that holds it all together is truth. It is the foundation. It holds all those other parts together. Thompson said, it's the knowledge of God's nature and his plan for human life, which has been revealed in Jesus. That is the truth. And where do we know this truth? God's word. John 8, 31 through 32 says this. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will what? Set you free. Knowing the truth sets us free from the lies of the enemy. Knowing the truth sets us free from false beliefs, sets us free from the institution of the world, and even sets us free from our own stinking human flesh. Right? Know the truth. So what do we need to do? Buckle up, buttercup. Secondly, breastplate of righteousness. The Roman soldier would wear this chain link shirt, basically, which would run from neck to waist, and it would cover all around from front to the back. Think of it like a bulletproof vest on steroids. It would cover it all, right? What does a breastplate do? It protects your, what's all up here? Oh, those are your vital organs. Those are those things you need, right, to stay alive. It's that heart that beats within your chest that pumps blood to the rest of your body. Okay, so those lungs with which you breathe, etc. So these are vital things that need to be protected. And our spiritual breastplate is righteousness. Now, there's two senses to this word righteousness. For those who are followers of Christ, his righteousness has been imputed upon us. By his blood, we stand in a right relationship with God. The end of the passage that Bobby Gupta so powerfully brought us last week in 2 Corinthians 5:21 says this, for our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So in Christ we have what we call imputed righteousness. We stand in right relationship with God. But not only is it positional righteousness, it is also practical righteousness as well. Wiersbe said, our positional righteousness in Christ without practical righteousness in the daily life only gives Satan opportunity to attack us. So it has to be both. Positionally righteous, yes, amen, but also practically every day. Right? Now, what does that look like? Well, right relationship produces right living, which then protects our hearts, our inner being, our temple, if you will. It's why Paul tells believers not to be yoked with unbelievers. Sorry, no missionary dating. It's not good. 2 Corinthians 6:14 through 16 says, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? What accord has Christ with Belial? Or what portion does a believer share with an unbeliever? What agreement has the temple of God with idols? For we are the temple of the living God. Now, that doesn't mean we don't love all of our neighbors. That doesn't mean we don't love our enemies and pray for them, even those who persecute us. But we cannot walk in that same sort of relationship with them that we do with our brothers and sisters in Christ. Okay? And why is that? Because we are the temple of the living God. So, tighten up that vest, y'all. Tighten it up. Thirdly, shoes of the readiness of the gospel of peace. Okay, first note that this is a very awkward phrase. It's translated, read every translation and you'll see it translated differently in just about every single one because it's kind of hard to translate. Is it talking about shoes? What sort of shoes is it talking about? Today we might think that the shoes of the Roman soldier, those weren't very good shoes, were they? What were they? They were sandals. That's not a good, I don't want to go to battle with sandals on, right? Anybody ever even tried running in sandals? What happens? But get this, those sandals, guess what they had on the bottom? They had these hobnails on the bottom. And so they would give them traction so that they could actually run fast. And they were faster than those who were coming against them. So there was a purpose behind those things. Think of it like cleats, right? If you're trying to run to first base without cleats, what's going to happen to you? You're not going to get out of the batter's box. You're going to be doing a running man there, not moving at all, right? So you need those things on. And with shoes, we're ready to go. And there's even more awkwardness in this phrase because what do the shoes represent? Is it peace? Is it readiness? Is it the gospel? Well, according to Boyce, with whom I agree, he said, in my judgment, the emphasis falls upon the readiness to make the gospel known. Readiness. So what is the gospel? The gospel is simply the good news of Jesus Christ, that in Christ, though we were sinners, God has reconciled, redeemed, forgiven, justified, made peace. In Romans 10, 14 through 15, how then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent, as it is written? How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. You see, it's the readiness of being ready to go out and to share that. Anybody have beautiful feet? I don't know about that one. So lace up. Lace up and be ready. Fourthly, shield of faith. Most likely, this is referring to the huge door-shaped shield of the Roman phalanx, which was covered in protective leather and doused with water, which would then be overlapped with the soldier standing next to you to make this impenetrable wall when besieging a city. That shield then was able to extinguish the fiery arrows raining down on them. Who's got their shield? Ready? Who's got their shield? Oh, I didn't even know there's water in that. That's silly. See, the enemy's arrows are on fire. The enemy's arrows will do real damage if we don't pick up that shield of faith. What is our shield? It's faith. We've talked much about faith when we studied Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. We were reminded that faith is confident trust in the object of our salvation, in Jesus Christ. 1 John 5, 4 through 5 says, for everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except for the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? Much like righteousness, this faith, though, is both positional and practical. By faith we are saved, and by faith we live. Faith overcomes. Faith extinguishes the attacks of the devil. Potzia said, faith is complete confidence in and reliance upon God to give the victory. So friends, if you don't want the enemy's darts flying at you, pick up that shield. Pick up that shield. And then we have the helmet of salvation. What do helmets do? They protect one's head. What's inside the head? Hopefully brains. Probably want to protect those things, right? Right? So why we have helmet laws to protect the young minds of our children. Our helmet is salvation. He's not even here, man! Our helmet is what? Salvation. Might we say it's the assurance of salvation? Ephesians 1:13 says, "In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit." You see, when the enemy tries to plant doubts in our minds, which doesn't he do that all the time? When we have the Holy Spirit of God, who is our seal, the fact of our salvation, our adoption as children of God, that is the best defense against the enemy. Westcott said, "The helmet guards the center of life. The sense of salvation puts life beyond all danger. It is the helmet which allows us to love God with all our minds." So, get that helmet on and tighten that strap. And then we have the sword of the Spirit. The Roman gladius is known as the sword that conquered the world. Did you know that? In close-range combat, it was a fearsome weapon in the hand of a skilled Roman soldier. When sharpened, its two edges wreaked havoc on unarmored foes, while its point could pierce through even heavy metal armor. Our sword, as the passage itself says, is what? It's the Word of God. Our sword is the Word of God. It is the sword of the Spirit, because it is the Spirit who inspired the authors to write it, and the Spirit who illumines it for us today to understand it and apply it. The Word of God is our offensive weapon in our battle against the enemy. When Jesus was tempted in the wilderness, how did he fight? What did he say? "It is written. It is written. It is written." Every temptation that faced him in answer to that, he quoted scripture. "It is written." I love what Hughes says. "May the lesson not be wasted. If Christ, the divine man in battling Satan while here on earth, did so with the sword of the word, how much more do we frail men and women need to wield that same sword if we are to be victorious?" How dare people think that we don't need this? How dare pastors stand in a pulpit and not preach from this? How dare they? Sorry. Hebrews 4:12. You know it well. "For the word of God is living and active. It is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart." Now, for those of us who are in rebellion to the Lord, for those of us who are in a place of not faithfully walking with him, of not taking our stand against the enemy, that might be a scary thing. Because if it pierces me, it might mean I have stuff I got to work on. Might mean I have to actually read it. Take it off that shelf and dust it off a little bit and start digging in, or you know, take it off. But then to do what it says. Because you know what James says about people who read the word and don't do it? It's like people who look into a mirror, walk away from that mirror, and forget what they look like. Does that make any sense to you? No, it's meant to be ridiculous. it's like the guy who comes out of the toilet stall with some toilet paper hanging from his pants, and you tell him, "Hey, look, you got some toilet paper hanging from your pants," and he looks at it and goes, "Oh, thanks," and continues to walk on. What do? You take that toilet paper out, dummy. Right? If God's word says this and we don't do it, we have no excuse. None. Whatsoever. That's why we need to know it. We need to study it. We need to dig into it. We need to meditate on it. We need to chew it like a cow chews his cud. Right? Getting every piece of nutrient out of it. So friends, unsheath that sword. Unsheath it. And then we come to the last little bit here. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18 through 20. It says this: "Praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints, and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth, boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. See, this passage ends in a call to stand constantly in prayer. Notice the little use of that word, the word all, four times, at all times, with all prayer, with all perseverance, for all the saints. Where's be called prayer? The energy that enables the Christian soldier to wear the armor and to wield the sword. Okay. Praying in the Spirit, as it says, is not some sort of weird mystical form of praying. It simply means this, that we're aware of the presence of the Holy Spirit and that we allow Him to even direct our prayers. Romans 8, 26 through 27 says, "Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought. But the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words, and He who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God." So even the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. He helps us to know what to pray for. How many of you have ever started to pray, and then you realize, man, I have no idea what I'm praying for right now? I don't know how to pray. I don't know what to say. I don't even know what, no words. And yet the Spirit, if we allow Him to, if we persevere in prayer, if we press in just a little bit more, the Spirit, it says, will speak with groans that cannot be understood by words. I have a feeling, and this might not be you, but I know it's me, that there are times when I sit down to pray that I give up way too easily, that I stop because I don't know what to pray for, or I'm not receiving the answers that I think I need to hear. But we all know how God answers prayer, right? Yes, no, and maybe. Yes, no, and wait. There's no maybes with God. God doesn't work that way. He's not a transactional kind of God. It's according to with His will. So it's yes, no, or wait. Right? And we got to do that constantly. There's an urgency even in this plea, right? Paul tells the church to keep alert. He tells them to persevere in prayer. When Nehemiah was rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem after they had been allowed to come back from captivity in Babylon, while he was rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem, the enemy was trying to halt his progress. How did he persevere? Nehemiah 4:9 says, "And we prayed." And we prayed to our God. And set a guard as a protection against them day and night. You see, watch and pray. Wait, didn't Jesus tell His disciples that too? As He went up on that mountainside, couldn't you just watch and pray? Just for a little bit? Watch and pray. And that might be one of the toughest things for us to do. None of us have ever fallen asleep while praying, right? None of us has given up praying for something because the Lord hasn't answered our prayer, right? Talked about that already. But friends, if we are soldiers in a spiritual battle, we must keep watch and persevere. Last week, I was sharing with the Friends in Christ class about the church in Sardis in Revelation. And this church in Sardis was situated upon a high cliff. Crazy. Cliffs of insanity, if you will. Nobody could scale that thing. And yet, two times in their history, they were attacked by a group who had scaled those cliffs. Why? Because they weren't watching. And the Lord tells the church at Sardis to watch. Open your eyes. Wake up, He says. Church, are we asleep today? I hope not. I hope we have our eyes open. I hope we're watching. I hope we're able to see the devil and his schemes and what he wants to do. We can only do that through prayer. Paul makes it then very personal. He requests the Ephesian church to pray specifically for him, that he would have the right words to say, that he would be bold in proclaiming the gospel. Notice that he doesn't pray for comfort and safety. Does he? What does he pray for? He prays for effectiveness. He prays for boldness. He prays that God would give him an opportunity to speak the truth, to declare the gospel. And what is Paul's situation right now? He's in chains. And yet, what does he call himself? An ambassador in chains. Last week, we learned what an ambassador was. An ambassador is a representative of the king sent to a foreign land to be his representative. And that's what we are called to do. And so although chained to Roman guards, Paul continues to effectively preach the gospel, to stand against the schemes of the enemy. And may he serve as an example to each of us as we engage in this battle, what the Lord has called us to do, despite the fact that there is a battle around us. So three stands as we close our time together today. Simply this. Stand strong. In who? In the Lord. Stand strong in the Lord. Stand firm in the armor of God. And stand constant in prayer. We're going to take a little bit of an extended time to pray. Band, you can come up and get ready too, but I'm going to give us a moment of silence. We need to stand. And in fact, will you stand? Let us stand in prayer. Let's physically stand and pray. And we don't need to bow our heads and close our eyes. Do you know how they prayed back in the day? They lifted their eyes and their hands up to the heavens. And let's stand in prayer. If you feel so inclined, please do that. Look up and lift your hands and pray. Let's stand strong. Father, I'm reminded of Moses as he stood on the hill overlooking the battle and his arms were being held up. And when his arms were held up, that's when the victory came. Lord, we lift our arms, we lift our hands to you, we lift our eyes to you because you are our source of strength. This world is not. It is you, Lord. And so, God, we surrender our lives to you. We pray, Lord, that you would give us the strength. We pray, Lord, that you would remind us again and again what this armor is all about, and that we would take up the full armor of God, that we would not miss any piece of it, but that our lives would be so covered, so saturated in you, that dressed for battle, we would go out and fight victoriously. Lord, if I may, I know that there are people in this room right now who are struggling in this spiritual battle. And the spiritual battle is real. There's oppression by the enemy. The enemy wants to sow seeds of fear. And darkness and depression and anxiety and addiction. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over that. Because the battle is yours. The battle is yours. It's in your awesome, mighty name we pray. Amen.
Let's stay standing. We're going to sing Sea of Victory.
weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I know told me how to triumph. Oh, my God will never fail. Yes, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will. I'm not backing down from any giant, 'cause I know how this story ends. Yes, I know how this story ends. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Turned it for good. You turned it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turned it for good. You turned it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turned it for good. You turned it. See a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle.
For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? The one who came, was born, who died, who rose again victoriously. The power of sin and death has been defeated. We stand in resurrected life, friends. Let us not cower before the enemy. Yes, the enemy is real. Let's not forget that fact. And so we need to be dressed for battle. But let us dress up and be ready to go and fight. And when we fight, we stand on our knees with our hands lifted high because the battle belongs to Him. Faith is the victory. And what? It's overcome the world. It's overcome the world. God bless you. Come back tonight for some good food. I'm excited. Thanksgiving potluck tonight, 5 p.m. over in the gym. Please come. Share in a time of thanksgiving for the victories that God has won in our lives. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you soon. Those watching at home, we love you.